My name is Nassime Saps.
Let me ask you a question. Has anything ever happened to you that you couldn't explain? That made you feel sort of foolish when you tried to tell somebody about it? Well, if it has, you have plenty of company, as you'll soon see.
Start right out. I can only make you one promise that what I've got to say is the truth. It won't seem that way to some of you. It'll always just seem that I'm either crazy or I'm the biggest liar and storyteller in the world. That's what our televisions have done to us. They've gotten us to a frame of mind that we do not realize the real world around us. When I talk in many youth rallies, many of the Christian schools, I start right out by tearing their television and rock idols down by personal experiences that I've had with them in the occult world. And then from there, we try to build them up with real heroes, the number one being Jesus Christ. But I come from a family that, where I grew up having my own heroes. My number one hero was my great-great-great, somewhere way back there, grandfather, named Francis Collins. Francis Collins owned the first ship that the Puritans landed in here. It just so happened that 50% of the people on board were also witchcraft people fleeing from Scotland. And they were called the Collinses. They were all his family. And that's how all witchcraft came to the United States. So when I grew up, I was being trained how great my family was, that it was the second most important family in the Illuminati in the occult world, and that someday I'd be very important and so on. So I had my own heroes. And television didn't help much. The reason I'm so down on television is I grew up around the television world, on the insides of it. When I was just a teenager, Hollywood paid for my way out to California so that I could bring a couple diaries that belonged to my family that I had inherited by will as the last male heir of the Collins family. If you wondered why that fits with Todd's, the Collins family changed their name about 100 years ago to Todd to cover up some of the things that they had done. But I'm sure some of you will remember the show Dark Shadows. That was the show that paid for me to come to Hollywood to bring the diaries. Many of the scripts were taken from actual incidences in the diaries. And for instance, Barnabas Collins was based upon a man named Prince Williams Collins, a Revolutionary War hero. When I was growing up in the occult world, we were always taught that we had been somebody else before. It wasn't good enough that we were the person we were now. We always had to be a dozen people that we were before. We had to deal with this life and all the ones we were supposed to have had before and all the ones we were going to have in the future. And I was supposed to be in Prince Williams Collins. As I said, that's who they based Barnabas on, so I wasn't exactly the nicest guy in the world. I grew up this way. When I was 13, I was taken into what is called the outer court to be trained as a priest in witchcraft. That had been like your pastor who just stepped off, or better yet, more like the youth director or something. When I was 18, I was initiated a high priest. That would have made me the pastor. At the same time, I became draft exempt. I did not have to go into service, but a bunch of us smart aleck young, I have to correct the pastor, not warlocks, but wizards and witches, went into the army because we felt the army really needed witchcraft. It just couldn't get along without us. And since the army didn't think that they needed any chaplains that were witches, we just kind of went in on our own. So I went on in, along with a lot of others. And I never did anything, I guess, halfway. I got in Vietnam, found out I liked Vietnam so well, I was willing to re-enlist. In fact, I'd already signed the papers to stay for another tour in Vietnam when I became wounded in the last month of the first tour, and I was shipped back to the United States. My time was almost up, so I was discharged, and the same day I re-enlisted. I asked for Vietnam, and they said because of my wounds that hadn't totally healed yet, I couldn't go to Vietnam yet, so I got Germany. And I had re-enlisted for 6 years. And until the time of my re-enlistment, I always thought that witchcraft was just witchcraft. There was nothing more to witchcraft than just casting spells, and that we were smarter than the Christians and other religions because we really knew who the gods were, and we were born with special powers because our ancestors had passed them down to us, and all the little stories they like to tell us. Witchcraft was a little different at that time. When I first got into it as a young person, you had to be from a family that had generations after generations of witchcraft. In order to be a coven member at the time, you had to have 3 generations at least. Well, the minimum that I had that we could find was 7. So there wasn't any problem, and we knew it went past that where there weren't records kept anymore. But that was all witchcraft was. As I tell many people, when, you know, many of you were raised as Christians, and I guess that's why I can't understand why some of the Christian teenagers are the way they are today. If they were raised in this glorious gospel, why they're so rebellious. I would have given anything to have been raised this way. But when you were learning the 23rd Psalm, I was learning the witch's chant. When you were reading about Moses opening the Red Sea, I was reading J.R.R. Tolkien. When you guys were learning different memory verses and so on, and the four spiritual laws and the Ten Commandments, I was happening to read C.S. Lewis. Of course, I've been greatly surprised that Christians read that too. But this is the way I grew up, and this is all I believed in, was just that there were mighty gods and we were spatial people. We were their priests and priestesses until I re-enlisted. I went to Germany, spent a month home, went to Germany, spent another month, 2 months out of a 6-year enlistment. One night while taking drugs and drinking, I shot and killed an officer in downtown Stuttgart. Now, if there's one thing that the Army does not like, it does not like its sergeants killing its officers. They have a quick cure for that. They threw me in solitary confinement. And as the court-martial proceeded on, and things began to look like I was going to spend the rest of my life in Leavenworth if I was lucky, all of a sudden a riot took place in the stockade, and although I was in solitary confinement, other people were placed in the cell with me. One of the men that was placed in the cell with me had been scheduled to get out that particular day and was held because of the riot. So I kind of talked him in by bribing him a little that if he made a long-distance phone call for me and told certain relatives of mine that I was in trouble, he'd receive some money for it and I'd be a lot happier. So he called collect to Los Angeles and talked to my foster mother, explained what the situation was. And I was sitting back waiting for her to get all these big witches together to cast spells on the judges and make all the officers that were trying me think I was a real nice guy and that it was self-defense and everything was going to be fine. They'd just let me off. Now, that's all that I had ever been taught that witches could do. But 3 days later, my cell door opened there in solitary. I stepped out in the light for the first time in 32 days. I heard some very strange words. You are honorably discharged from the United States Army. And the man that was saying them was a senator by the name of William Saxby. He had a congressman with him named Wiley and about 3 or 4 generals. And they were handing me an honorable discharge. And on the discharge papers, it didn't say I was bad, didn't say that I had been in jail, didn't say anything. It gave me all my time and rank, security clearances that I had in my possession, and didn't explain why I still had over 5 years to go in the United States Army. It just discharged me honorably. So as I took it, didn't want to argue with them, and left and went back to the States and arrived at my home in Columbus, Ohio. I asked my real mother, I have two mothers, foster mother and a real mother, I said, what type of spell is so good that it makes senators and generals do what you want? And it's a really good spell. I'd like to learn it. She just looked at me and said, you just don't understand, do you? She said, we didn't cast a spell on them. They're with us. I said, oh, far out. Senators that are witches. She says, no, they just belong to us. And I didn't understand what she was saying. And I said, well, what am I supposed to do now? You know, I'd like to take my old coven back over and so on. So she handed me an envelope that had been waiting there. She'd explained that there was one there and one in Los Angeles. They didn't quite know where I was going to show up. I opened the envelope. Very intriguing thing. $2,000 in $100 bills. A lot of money. Also was a one-way plane ticket to New York City. I said, well, what's this for? She said, well, you make a reservation, you get on the next plane, you get out of here and you get to New York City and they'll meet you at the airport. I said, well, who are they? And where did this money come from? She says, you get there, and they'll tell you, and you'll know who's supposed to meet you when you get there. Now, witches are very curious people. That's why when we do some of the most demonic rites imaginable, and our hair would stand on end and almost turn snow white overnight from all the spooky things, we couldn't wait to get back in there. We were always curious what was going to happen the next. So I got on the plane, and I flew to New York, and I got off the plane. Sure enough, no problem with recognizing who met me. I'd read his books for years. In fact, he's the man who first created Christian witchcraft. His name was Dr. Raymond Buckland, head of the anthropology department, Columbia University. At that time, he isn't now. Graduate of Oxford University, Rhodes Scholar, handpicked by the Rothschilds to lead the Illuminati for him. So I arrived and He took me to his house, and next few months he carefully rearranged all my ideas for me. He told me that all the things that I had learned about witchcraft were just stories that we told the lower people. And where I thought there was only three levels and I was as high and as powerful as a witch could go, he assured me there were three more. I guess I should have backed off then, figured if I was lied to the first time, maybe I'd be lied to the second time. But as I said, witches have an incurable curiosity. They've got to find out everything. So I let him train me. He explained to me that since I was a male Collins, I was in the Collins family, that I had a position to take. And that there was a board of directors called the Grand Druid Council, which contained 13 of the most powerful witches in the world. And that my place was on that council. And I said, oh, you know, great. When do I take it? And he said, well, somebody just died. I kind of always wondered if he died or they shot him or something. You never can tell in the Illuminati. But he sent me to Los Angeles. I studied for 6 more months with my foster mother, holding kind of a temporary rank on this council, and then taking up the Colorado Springs and initiated. And I do believe that when I testified here at the last time, I explained who the person was that handed me the ceremonial knife for that ceremony. Another senator named George McGovern. You might, before the night gets over, start to realize that Washington isn't bad as you thought it was. It's worse. But the ceremony, by the way, was human sacrifice. And the leader of that ceremony that night was George McGovern. That's why when we did the Broken Cross, we drew his picture into the Broken Cross as a person practicing human sacrifice. But after the ceremony, I went down to San Antonio and decided that would be the perfect place. And I moved into San Antonio to watch all the drug traffic in the area, and I was given a 13-state area. That totaled out to about 65,000 initiated witches and wizards, priests and priestesses. Now that's just the staff of the church. That's not the congregation. So if there's that many ministers in that area, you can imagine what the population is. In California, whereas most of the Grand Druids have many states like I did, I had 13, California has a Grand Druid all to itself because there's that many witches in California. In fact, it's the most populated area in the world for witchcraft. This is where I lived. I only left it 8 times a year to attend what we called council meetings. Now, to give you an idea, Monday was one of those council meetings. They hold them 8 times a year. May 1st, they held a council meeting, and from our information, they held it in San Francisco. So you were kind of close to it this time. Because they kept talking about controlling the world. And I thought, let's stay back with witchcraft, you know, this world government thing. You know, they're a little weird. Witches are never going to control the world. And finally, on August the 1st, 1972, things changed. Courier from the London Embassy, a member of our United States State Department, arrived with a courier document pouch sealed with the crest of the State Department, brought it through customs, unopened, nobody could touch it, brought it in to San Antonio, and I was hosting the meeting this time. It was on Latimus, August the 1st. The man came in, laid the pouch down in the temple room up in the casino building, walked out, and left it. He wasn't to know what was in it. Now, in the Illuminati, the Rothschilds are not humans. They're not just the richest family in the world. They are gods in human bodies. More or less the counterfeit of what Jesus Christ was when he was on the earth. They're the sons and daughters of Lucifer in human body, and his wife, and so on. So that this council that I was on is the private priesthood of those gods. And when those gods talk, the priests listen and the priestesses listen, then they tell political people. That's why a handful of witches have so much power over so many political people. So we opened this one in Philip Rothschild's handwriting, and it would have been the same to what it was like, you know, the gods sent their own private message. So we opened it up. Dr. Buckland started reading it. It's a chart. A friend of mine, Dr. Tom Berry, has placed that chart in a 30-page book, and we're proofing it now, and Dr. Stuart Crane is going to publish it, and we hope to have it in Christian's hands in about 3 months. It's a step-by-step plan beginning in 1973, at the first of the year, to the end of 1980, to take over the world by taking over the United States.